So thanks for coming. I'm actually replacing Alyosha Kretek, who is sick today. And he did the slides and all the work, so I'm just presenting. So as I said, my name is Kostas Kloudas, and I'm a software engineer at Data Artisans. Data Artisans is a company founded by the original creators of Apache Flink and the company behind the DA platform and streaming infrastructure with Flink at its core. So enough with the introductions. So let's see what is stream processing and why it is useful for any organization. To do this, I will use the example of detecting suspicious behavior, as this seems to be a pretty hot topic for the usual suspects, banking, where they want to monitor user activity, card transactions, user interactions and stuff, but not only for that. It's also for organizations that use, for example, collaborative software or even email, and they want to monitor who shares what with whom. For example, you want to know if somebody shared a document with a competitor, let's say. So you have your some service that keeps on creating data, and you want to be able to specify some rules that will be evaluated against this data, never-ending streams of data. And you want your whole system to spit out alerts when, for example, a user has more than 10 failed login attempts within 1 second. This can be a bot. Or you share more than 100 files within 1 hour. The impossible travel scenario where you have a transaction with a card from the US and after 1 second, a transaction from China with the same card. Or the continuously increasing withdrawal amounts, meaning that you try to reach the limit, essentially. So for all of these cases, these are pretty common. Why not using a single machine? You take your data, you throw them all in, and you hope for the best, essentially. As long as the machine can hold up the load, you are perfectly fine. You don't have to worry about consistency. You don't have to worry about monitoring distributed systems, nothing. Everything is good. But what happens when the load increases, when your system from testing goes to production, and you have, instead of one user, you have hundreds, millions of them? Then the classic approach is that you ditch the solution of one machine, and you go to a classic batch processor. These are some examples, MapReduce, Spark, and the like. And you set them up. You launch your job overnight, every night. And they take care of coordination, fault tolerance, and everything. That's good, but as I said, this may run overnight. And what if you want your alerts to be, I mean, is it useful to have an alert about a fraudulent card transaction after 1 day, or that one person in your organization shared critical documents with a competitor the day before? Probably not. So what happens when you need real-time alerts or real-time processing of your data? Then in that case, you need a stream processor. Streams are essentially never-ending streams, flows of data coming into your system. And Apache Flink is a real-time distributed stateful and fault-tolerant stream processor. In stream processors, as I said, first-class citizens are flows, the arrows or streams of data, and you apply computations or operators on these streams of data. Here you see you have the source that reads from your external system and ingests the data. Then you have some user-defined functions that filter, transform, and in general massage your data so that they can be further processed. And then you can either store them in your preferred storage system or forward them for further processing. In this case, it's the rules that you have to keep in your own state, preferably managed by the framework for consistency and fault tolerance reasons, and you send the alerts at the sink. So in stream processing, we think in terms of flows and operators applied to these flows. Why thinking of flows and operators? The first reason is because real-time data come in flows and you apply operators. Time doesn't stop. You don't have a clear start and end of like a file system, like in the classic file systems. And also, from a more programmer's perspective or system perspective, operators can be composed and can be combined in different ways. So in an organization, different teams or different groups of engineers can write different operators, and then it's up to the users how to combine them and fix their pipelines. And apart from that, for a system, thinking about flows and operators allows it to distribute it more efficiently and handle, execute them on different machines and execute the same operations multiple times in order to deal with high load. So this means essentially the first distribution is distribute these operators on different, each one of them on different machines if necessary, but also scale each one of them in multiple machines so that when the load increases, you just your job doesn't fail. So, Apache Flink, as I said, is a distributed stream processor, fault-tolerant stream processor. So we have the graph that I showed before. Flink has nice APIs in order to define these graphs and handle state and everything. It handles it actually transparently. It will take your computation and it will distribute it into your the available machines that you provide in a way that will guarantee that your job will not fail due to lack of resources, as long, of course, as you provide enough of them. So if you can see in the distribution, the heavy operation of applying the rules is running on both machines, and Flink takes care of coordination, fault tolerance, and handling the time. More on this, I will briefly mention it, but it's the difference between event time and processing time, for those of you who know. Yes. Twice. So what is a good stream processor? There are many stream processors. All of them, they provide some functionality. What are the required properties from a stream processor in order to be a good stream processor? It has to answer the following questions. What happens when machines fail or when your code is buggy? How will it handle a failure like this? What happens if you have your state, for example, your rules, but you want to move your computation to different machines because you scale up, you scale down, or you change cloud provider? What happens if you need to change the scheme of your state, meaning that you have your rules, but you want to update a field or something similar? How can I update either my framework, meaning for Flink, you go from version X to version Y, but you don't want your job to start processing from the beginning of time, but at some point where you stopped from the previous version, or you want to update your user code because either you found a bug or you want to have A/B testing. You build a model, you train a model, you have a parameter that you want to change from 1.2 to 1.3. Does it mean that you have to reprocess everything? So that's it about stream processing and Flink. Now, let's see some common use cases that we've seen through our interaction with users. We will present actually three categories, with the first one of them being aggregation of timestamp data. This may seem like the simplest one, but it's pretty widely used. So you have use cases where you want to answer questions, give me the number of tweet impressions per tweet, per day, minute, or whatever, for every user. Calculate the average temperature over 10-minute intervals for my sensors, for example, in my cloud infrastructure, or aggregate user interaction data for my website to display on my internal dashboards, stuff like that. All these fall into the same category, and the graph, the job graph in Flink jargon, would look something like this. You have a source where you ingest data, you have a sink where you store your data, and in between, you have a stateful computation called windowed aggregation, where essentially incoming data get appended into a window from 10 to 11, let's say. And when the time is right, and I will elaborate a little bit on the time is right notion in the next slides, it fires and it tells you how many tweets or how many clicks you received. State, what I have to mention is that, as I said, Flink is a stateful stream processor, so it transparently handles things like fault tolerance. You don't have to worry about this stuff. So when it comes to a simple, visually at least, job like this, things that you have to account for is what notion of time do you want to work with? Again, in Flink terms, this is event and processing time, or not only Flink terms, also other stream processing frameworks. The data flow model, essentially, terms them event time or processing time. Event time is the timestamp of the element. Processing time is the timestamp of the system dot current time millis on the machine that you are processing the element, meaning that in event time, if you want to process clicks and the clicks have a timestamp, in event time, you will expect the timestamp when the click happened. While in processing time, it means that if the user goes offline and he buffers the data and then he sends the click data to after 1 hour when he goes back online, the processing time will be 1 hour later. So do you want to work on event time or processing time? Flink handles both of them. If you're using event time, respecting the timestamp of the click, how do I know that my window is done? Meaning that, okay, I will not receive more elements for the time for the window between 10 and 11, so I can send my data, do my aggregation and send my data. What happens if data arrives out of order? As I said before, you may disconnect, reconnect, and send batched data together. This means that you have data from 10 to 11 that you will send at 12. How will they be processed, and how will the stream engine know that these data belong to the 10-11 window and not further down the timeline? If you're using event time again, when is data considered late? Meaning that when should I discard data? And what should I do with this discarded data? Should I silently drop them, or should I forward them to a storage system or to for manual inspection? All this you should think when you are writing your job, and Flink handles them, provides APIs to do them, to do so efficiently, some more transparent than others. For example, handling out of order events, you don't have to worry about it. Lateness, you should also provide a parameter which says how much lateness is good enough. It can be absorbed. So Flink features to look at. I will not be exhaustive on that. These are just pointers in the documentation that you can look for. It's the windowing API, Flink's windowing API, timestamp assigners, and watermark extractors. Essentially, what timestamp to respect is the timestamp is extracted from the elements by the timestamp extractor. And the watermarks are the clock ticks in event time that signal that, OK, now it's time 11, now it's time 12. The allowed lateness, when to drop data, and the side output for late data, meaning how do you handle the ones that are dropped as late, the elements that are dropped as late. So this is the category, and this would be the job graph if it's the previous one on top, and if you want to handle have a special handle for the dropped data as late, then it's the arrow with the side output late data. For example, in this case, you can send to humans for manual inspection. Send to humans. Send to people for manual inspection. Yeah. So let's move to the second category of use cases. This is enriching data with a side input. This means that you have your data coming in with a user ID, and somewhere you've stored in an external storage system, a database, what this user ID corresponds to, name, address, and whatever, and you want to join these two. This can be, as I said, user data or geolocation with geotagged events and stuff like that. In this case, the graph is pretty similar. In the gray ones, you see what was also in the previous slide, the previous use case. The only difference is that now you may filter to clean up the data that are useful for you, and then you enrich. And this is where the magic happens. This is where you have to handle how to do the enrichment. The first and probably naive approach is you use simple maps in a map function. You keep a connection, and for every incoming element, you emit. You keep a connection to your database, for example. And for each incoming element, you just send a synchronous request to the database to fetch the relevant data for that key. Of course, this is we term this naive approach because although it can be good enough for low throughput systems, you can imagine that it can easily be suffer from high latencies because you are bound to the latency of your database or your external storage system. So, and this is because you have synchronous access to the external storage system. A slightly better approach is to use the async I/O functionality provided by Flink, where it allows you to have asynchronous access patterns to your external storage system. This means that you can multiplex essentially requests with responses, so that for each request you don't wait for the response, but you send more requests, and this will lead to smaller perceived latencies from the external storage system. In all this, in async I/O, Flink will take care of of monitoring the order of the incoming requests, the elements, and handling them in case of failure. For example, if you have a failure, the pending requests will be resubmitted to the external storage system. And if you want, you can emit the results at the same order as the requests came. So all these play well with what I said before about event time handling. So you will not, if it takes too long to contact the database, it doesn't mean that the response will be dropped as late just because of that. And finally, we talked about synchronous access. We talked about asynchronous access. The third more pure streaming way is that instead of accessing an external storage system for the enrichment data, you just plug in, connect your mainstream with a change log of your enrichment data. You connect these two, and you store the enrichment data in Flink's managed state, and you use this state in order to enrich the incoming data from your mainstream. Again, Flink takes care of time handling, state handling, and consistency in that case. Hop. So, yes, that's it. And Flink, as a summary of things to look in documentation or talks that you can find online, is regular users, functions, and operations for the synchronous pattern. Async I/O operations for the async access to the external storage system. And two input operations and stateful operations, connected streams and stuff, for the changelog approach. So that is the second category of approaches, enrichment of data. And the final one, which is rather new, it was supported before, but proper support for this came in Flink 1.5. Actually, Nico gave a talk yesterday. It's dynamic processing. In this case, you have I don't have a slide, but so you have the rules that I mentioned before, and you want these rules to be broadcasted to all operators to all tasks that do the evaluation, and you want these rules to be updated at runtime. You don't want to stop your job, put them in an external storage system, and then from this external storage system fetch them at runtime. So these are update of processing rules via DSL. This is actually something that came a lot as a request from for complex event processing to us, and the live update of machine learning models. So in that case, you will have again your mainstream on the bottom, pre-processing, cleaning up the data, whatever, and you have a stream of rules that is broadcasted to all downstream tasks. They are stored in broadcast state. This is local state to each task that and the main characteristic of the broadcast state is that it will contain across all tasks the same state. And dynamic processing is the operator that will evaluate these rules over the incoming events. For this, pointers to look at is the process function, which gives you and all the flavors of process function that gives you access to timers, state, and the events themselves. So all the building blocks to build your own windowing mechanism or whatever you want. And broadcast streams and broadcast state that make sure that all rules in this case go to all operators downstream. So these are the three categories of use cases that I wanted to touch. Aggregation over window over timestamp data, enrichment, data enrichment, and broadcast dynamic processing. So for closing, The main takeaways is that if you want immediate results, then probably you need a stream processor. As a paradigm shift, it makes sense to start thinking in terms of flows and reusable operations. And time handling should also come afterwards, event time and stuff. Getting state handling, fault tolerance, and event time handling, and also efficiency is a difficult job. We're still working on it, but we're pretty good. And Flink has your use case covered. Another announcement is that in the very same building in September, we have Flink Forward, the Berlin version. And you're more than welcome to join us. And that's it. If you wanna, you can follow the Dartians and Apache Flink on Twitter or email us, and don't forget that we're hiring. Thanks.
Well, we've been pretty efficient with the talk. We've got plenty of time for questions, comments. Is there anything in the audience? Far back right. Here you go.
Hi there. So I think in the second example, you were showing how enriching data, you were giving the example with the user IDs and loading something from the database, but then the third solution was something with a changelog, like putting hooking in the changelog. How does that, I don't know, it didn't connect in my head so much, like how does that switch the call to the database?
How does it switch what, sorry?
Like how would putting in this kind of changelog thing solve the problem of connecting like this user data from a user ID?
Because you are not there is a DevOps side. You don't have to handle an external storage system, one more external storage system. And the second thing is that you are not bound to the latency of the external storage system. For example, organizations, again on the DevOps side, sometimes we hear that the system is managed by team Y, and we don't have access, or we don't have the throttle accesses. And another thing is that here, from a systems perspective, you are bound, as I said before, to the database handling of things. While here, you have stream all the way, stream Flink all the way. I don't know if this answers your question.
I meant less from a data, from a kind of operations kind of point of view, more from like, what is this data? How is this changelog input actually? How is the user data actually there? Are you just building this user from this changelog input?
What you can do is that, I mean, before arriving to this point, there is a way that the data end up in your database, external storage system, whatever this is. So instead of putting it in the database, in addition to putting it in the database, organizations put it into a queue as well, the same data. And you read, when it comes to stream processing, instead of contacting the database, you use the changelog that you forward. Yes.
Okay, thanks.
No problem.
So you say one might think of a redo log of a database.
What? Sorry?
So that would be something like a database redo log.
Yes, I mean, yeah.
All right. Any more questions in the meantime? Front right.
So it seems that Apache Kafka can do some of the same things that you explain here. Can you describe what the difference between Flink and Kafka are, and why would you use Flink rather than Kafka?
I'm not so familiar with how Kafka is doing things. I'm not trying to avoid the question. I'm really not. I mean, I'm an engineer at Flink. I'm not a user of Flink, and also I'm not a user of K-streams. I can answer more specific questions if you have for Flink itself. One main thing that I can see is that, first of all, we're not that bound to Kafka, meaning that sources, sinks can be whatever, and whatever happens, all these arrows are internally, it's network transfer. There is no Kafka involved here. Apart from that, I don't know if there are any limitations from on Kafka streams on how they handle state, how they handle time. I'm not so familiar. But probably if you give me more insights, I can tell you how we do it, and you can tell me how Kafka streams does it.
More questions? Oh, there's one right here. Let's take that one first.
Can you go over briefly how time is dealt with, ordering is dealt with in a distributed environment?
Yes. Apart from all these arrows here, apart from the events themselves that come in, they have some special markers. One of them is for fault tolerance, called checkpoint barriers, and the other is watermarks. Watermarks are elements that have a timestamp. This is what you defined actually with a watermark emitter that it's user function. It's a user-defined function. You specify what timestamp each watermark will have, and how often will it be emitted. And these special elements essentially form a partial order between the events. Whatever is, if watermark has a timestamp 10, this conceptually for Flink will mean that all the elements that you've seen, no elements after this watermark, will come with timestamp higher than smaller than 10. So you've processed, from Flink's perspective, you've processed everything up to 10, whatever this is, hours or whatever. And then the magic is on how you define this watermark assigner so that it can handle your data. If you have a lot of lateness, because your users tend to be too much time offline and send their data one day later, then you can hold back the watermark one day and say, okay, although it's today the 12th, put a timestamp of 11th of June, because I know that my data will come one day later. So this is, in a nutshell, how this happens. And for more details, I suppose that it's better to look at the documentation, or we can discuss outside. I will stay here.
All right, next question up here.
Hi, thanks for the talk. So exactly at this slide, mm-hmm. Is there a way to, if this changelog input is event sourced, so I also have a timestamped update, mm-hmm. and I have late events on the bottom row. Mm-hmm. Is there a way to merge them? For example, the user info was updated at this point in time, and I can merge it based on the timestamp which I have in the mm-hmm. the data in the lower ground.
There are ways to do it, but it's your code that will do it. It's not Flink, because for what you said, this is not exactly timestamp. It's versions. You wanna say, do a point in time join. You want to say that if I receive an element at 10, join it with the user data that I have for that user at 10, even though now I may have newer versions for that user, right? So in this case, the upper stream, it's not timed, it's just that it has a version. Inside the enrichment operator, you will keep it in Flink state with a timestamp. And when an element comes from your main stream, you will just say, okay, fetch me this user ID for this timestamp. And then you do the enrichment.
All right, more questions? I got one.
Yes?
You mentioned the asynchronous communication pattern with external sources.
Mm-hmm.
Can you say something about the back pressure mechanism you have in place there?
Sorry, yeah, say something about?
Do you have, I suppose there's a back pressure mechanism
mm-hmm.
Because you communicate asynchronously. What if the external source doesn't keep up with the load you put into
mm-hmm.
it?
Yes. So in that case, conceptually what happens is that we have a queue of futures. So you send your request, a bounded queue of futures. There are some, it comes in some flavors, one of them being keep the order, and the other one is don't keep the order of the requests when you present the result. Anyway, you have a queue of futures. Each one of the futures in the queue represents a request that you've sent already. When this queue becomes full, then you stop processing, essentially back pressure, what you said. And when this, depending on your emitting strategy, when this all the requests have finished, or some of them have finished, You start a meeting, and you keep on processing at the tail of the queue. You keep on appending data at the tail of the queue. And the thing that I forgot to mention is that this could lead, if you don't properly handle the watermarks and what I said before about event time, this could lead to sending a request. The response came coming back too late. So downstream, if you do a window, then you may drop the responses late. So also, this is integrated with windowing and fault tolerance so that you don't lose anything. You have exactly one semantics, fault tolerance, plus respecting event time with the watermarks and stuff. Yes.
I see, thanks.
No problem.
If there are no more further questions, I conclude this talk. Let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.